creation. O Lord, my God, when I'm awesome wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. And I ask people sometimes, as we're singing this first verse, think about a time or two or three, I mean, however many you can, where you were in God's creation and it took your breath away. You said, oh, would you look at that? And I remember one time in the fall, driving in northern Wisconsin, I'll never forget it. I stopped the car so many times to take pictures of the trees that we almost got late for where we were going. The colors were just incredible. And I've been other places all around the world where I've said, oh, would you look at that? And that's what this first verse in this song is all about. Other verses talk about the cross. The last verse in the hymn, the theme, has to do with the second coming of Christ. But let's sing this first verse. Think about those times that you've had all throughout your life when you've just said, oh, God did a good job on that tree, or that ocean, or that mountain, or that desert. Oh, Lord, my God, when I'm awesome wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power of God, the universe is displayed.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, his mercy has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We'll join in reading our intro at responsively half verse by half verse, and joining the glory be to the Father.
I will speak of your testimonies before kings, O Lord.
And so
soul makes its boast in the Lord.
Let the humble hear and be glad.
Come, O children, listen to me.
I will teach you the fear of the Lord.
The Lord redeems the life of his servants.
None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
I will speak of your testimonies before kings, O Lord,
and shall not be put to shame.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. We'll just speak the responses. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
If you can sing it with me a cappella, I encourage you to do so.
This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Worthy is Christ the Lamb who was slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God. This is the feast.
Four men unbound, walking in the midst of the fire, and they are
next generation,
that this is God, our God, forever.
Our epistles from Romans, chapter 3. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood, to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel, and let's join together in singing the Alleluia verse.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel is, according to St. John, the 8th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are offspring of Abraham, and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say, you will become free?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The Son remains forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let's join and confess our faith together in the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You may be seated, and back over to you guys.
Well, I think we ought to sing a song that we don't need any screens for. And I want you to pretend as though you're 6 years old. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones do him belong. We are weak, but he is strong. Scott Hope and I could meet up with some of the kids that were in chapel there this morning.
Online.
Is there anybody here like that? No? Okay. But we sang the second verse of this song, or one of the other verses that probably nobody here has ever heard before. And I explained to the children that were watching, and apparently there were at least 80 or 90 of them or something like that, what the words meant. I'm not going to do that this morning. Roger and I are just going to sing it for you. A little boy taught this to us in Anchorage, Alaska a few years ago. Jesus loves the Eskimo. Mushing dog sleds through the snow. Indians and Aleuts. Prairie mucklucks for their boots. Yes, Jesus loves them. Probably knew this, that Lutherans say amen best if it's in bold print.
Right.
You get a Lutheran worship service, and if somebody says amen at the wrong time, you know you got a little bit of chaos on your hands, and you're sitting there going, oh, we have a visitor this morning who doesn't know we do it all together or not at all. Now, next time pastor's preaching, and if you get so blessed you can't hold back, you know what you could do? You could say amen and see if he loses his place. And we will have left town, and we, you know, probably will never know. Nobody's even going to tell us what happened. But anyway. So we're glad to be in Green Bay. Wow, what a famous town. And I've already gone through the whole itinerary of where we're going to be in the days to come. Lisa, we get to stay with very dear friends tomorrow night a few miles out of Tomahawk. And then on the weekend, we are back in Wausau and then down to Marshville. And on Monday, we fly home. And for home for me, as I've said, is Phoenix for the last 34 years. Home for Roger is Southern California. So, and he apologizes for that, but nothing, huh?
California.
Yeah. Anyway, that's where he lives. Roger and I represent a ministry that is, I'm sure, new to pretty much all of you. The ministry is called Shepherd's Canyon Retreat. You can see the banner stand up here. And, oh, there's our logo.
Sure.
Are there slides up there too?
Well, of course we have slides.
Oh, and I didn't know. Well, we have, okay, let me first of all tell you what our ministry does. We provide week-long counseling retreats for men and women in full-time ministry. Are you ready? Who are in the midst of burnout, stress, depression, compassion fatigue, and conflicts of all kinds. Last Monday, our 93rd counseling retreat concluded. Monday morning with breakfast. They begin with dinner on Monday evening and conclude 1 week later. And during that week, people that are there as clients will receive about 23 hours of counseling, led by two counselors, Christian licensed counselors, male and female, and then the retreat chaplain, who's the pastor to the retreat. And then we have a staff of people that provide fabulous hospitality, meals, comfort. We kind of say it's four-star hospitality. I'm not sure about five-star, but four is, you know, that's pretty good. We have a retreat center where these counseling retreats take place. And the retreat center is 90 minutes northwest of Phoenix. Have you folks in Dakota Mesa, have you ever been in Wickenburg? Well, we're 15 miles. Next time you come to Mesa, you got to get in your car and come out and visit our retreat center, right?
Yeah.
We'd love that. We're 15 miles from Arizona's cowboy town called Wickenburg. In fact, if this was Arizona tonight, And I've said this many times, we're 15 miles west of Arizona's cowboy town called, and the whole audience would say Wickenburg, because everybody in Arizona knows that it's the team roping capital of America, and, you know, horses. And October through March, 8 or 9 or 10,000 people come, not snowbirds like these folks that go to Mesa. Forget that. These folks come with horse trailers. and anyway, that's the culture in that community. We're 50 miles out in ranch country. It's a beautiful place. The name of the retreat center is Standing Stones. And when we bought the property a number of years ago, we came to an entrance. Can I see the next slide? And here was a driveway with palm trees on both sides. It looked kind of like we were coming into a resort. There was a duplex at the end of the driveway, and we used that duplex for our counseling retreats for 3 years until we built that building over on the left. It's called the Fellowship House. There's another picture of it, and there's one more. And then if you go inside that building, the retreat we just got done with, the clients would sit in those red chairs for their group counseling. There's bedrooms, two on that side, two on this side, two here and two there, 8 all together. And the bedrooms look like that, except if you're a married couple, then those twin beds come together and put a memory foam on top, and you've got a king-size bed, okay? Then, in another part of our property, we've got a prayer garden. Those are our standing stone monuments. You know, the old prophets in the Old Testament erected rock monuments. You remember that? When they wanted to commemorate that God did this thing, this great thing right here. We're going to pile up a pile of rocks, and it's going to help us remember that this is the spot where God did what he did. Moses, Jacob, Samuel, Joshua, and so forth. Well, that's why our retreat center is called Standing Stones, and those are our two monuments. The next slide shows you another slice of our beautiful prayer garden. It is just gorgeous. And then one more, and that shows you our outdoor chapel. And you see those boulders? Those are the pews. Folks, if you come, you bring your own padding. You can interpret that any way you want, okay? And we can just, you can leave it at that picture right there for a while. We've had a lot of people come. Yesterday I got an email from a pastor from Iowa. He said, I just resigned from my congregation, and I don't know any details, but it sounds like that was the result of a crisis of some kind or another. And our district president has encouraged my wife and I to come to one of your retreats. So I said, wonderful. And people don't come to these retreats to sort of put their feet up for a week in Arizona and relax. It's heavy lifting. The results of this ministry are just miraculous. Lives are saved, I mean literally. I'm not going to go any further with that statement. Marriages, ministries, and quite a few people have come from what's called Wisconsin North. And your district president in Wausau has been very encouraging to this ministry. I grew up in a home that pointed people to Jesus. My mom and dad, for the first 7 years of their marriage, way before I was born, they weren't pointing anybody to Jesus. They weren't going to church. They didn't read the Bible. They didn't pray. And then they went to a little Lutheran church in South Minneapolis because they heard that a classmate of theirs from high school was preaching. And they thought, well, we better go listen to this guy preach. And they heard some kind of preaching like they had never heard before. And on the Sunday morning after the service, a lady asked my mom, are you and your husband coming to the Sunday night, the service tonight? And my mom, in a weak moment, said yes. And then told my dad. My dad said, nothing doing. We're not going to church twice in one day. They hadn't been to church once in one day for years, much less twice. But if my dad was here to tell you the story, I heard him say, but I went anyway. So they went to the Sunday night service, and then you know what happened? There was some singing, and then the pastor preached a little bit. And then there was a time somewhere in there where the pastor said, does anybody here have a testimony you'd like to share? Are you sitting down? This is in a Lutheran church on a Sunday night. And so one person would pop up and say, I've got something I'd like to share. And then another person. My folks sat there and thought, what in the world is this? Who are these people? People that they grew up with never said a word about what they believed about the Bible or faith in Jesus Christ. I mean, they went to church as kids. But it was this kind of very cold, stiff kind of setting. And so now they're hearing people give faith stories. See, if you say testimonies, you kind of people think, well, it must be Baptists. Anyway, it wasn't. It was a Lutheran church. Well, the third Sunday night, are you getting this? First Sunday night, second night. My dad and mom came to faith. They were converted. They went to Bible school, and then they became missionaries, and then my dad served churches. Well, when I came along, my mom and dad were pointing me and a bunch of other people to faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And when they died some years ago, they left a legacy. It had nothing to do with money, not a thing. It had everything to do with examples of faith from their words and their actions. Now, one of these days, you're going to cross the finish line. So will I. Probably not on us all on the same day. And people are going to talk about you. And they're going to say, remember when? And then they're going to start quoting some words that you shared or some encouragement that you shared or maybe the fact that you said to them, I'm praying for you. And they're never going to forget it. So I'm just praying right now that as you run the race and as I run the race, we're making a difference in the lives of people who are coming behind us. They're watching us. They're listening to us. What we say and what we do makes a big difference in their lives. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, that was a good one. Here's the song. So think about the race you're running and what people are hearing and what they're seeing from you in your life and the race that you're running.
We're pilgrims on the journey of the narrow road. Those have gone before us line the way. They're cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary. Their lives a stirring testament of God's sustaining grace.
Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us, let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly lives. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey.
My three daughters are getting behind with their three grandkids. Will they see Jesus working in my life? I pray. Because after all our hopes and dreams have come and gone, and our children sift through all we've left behind, may
discover, and the memories they uncover
become the light that leads them to the road we each must find.
Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we fire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful.
Amen.
Amen.
Good. Sing a couple more songs, if that's okay with you. Many years ago when I lived in L.A., I got to know my first black friend. Pastor, you mentioned his name when we were in your office a few minutes ago. His name was Andre Crouch. Some of you have maybe sung some of his songs. He impacted gospel music for 50 years. Well, I heard him sing this song. He'd written it probably, I don't know, recently before I heard him. And I thought, I'm going to sing that song, and I've been doing it for a lot of years. I've had many tears and sorrows, and I've had questions for tomorrow. And there have been times I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave blessed consolation. Let my trials come to only make me strong. Through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. Gives each of the clients a river rock and a Sharpie pen. the chaplain says, sometime this afternoon, would you please write on the rock what you're leaving behind here? So if you were a volunteer out at our retreat center, I'm one of those people sometimes, you could look around our property. We have 9 acres of property, and somebody could be sitting over there with their pen and their rock, and you kind of wonder, I wonder what they're going to write. 4:30 on Sunday afternoon, they go out to the prayer garden, and if you could give me the next slide, they stand around that altar, and then they stand around the altar and they read to each other what they've written on their rock. And then the next slide, please, they place their rock at the foot of the cross. I took that picture after a retreat a few months ago. And a month or two or three or four after a retreat, the weather kind of just wears off the words. So if you were there out there now, you would see what has been written on the rock just this last Sunday. But there's a rock up there that says regret. It's the one that's upside down. And I know that there are a couple of rocks in the pile that say, I'm leaving shame at the foot of the cross. This rock says hopelessness. The pastor that put this rock there, his name is Bill, and the reason I know that is because a week after the retreat, he wrote me an email and said, if you see a rock that says hopelessness, I'm the one that put it there. Serves a congregation of 600-700 people on a weekend. He's come back twice as the retreat chaplain. That's a big deal. But can you imagine leaving hopelessness behind you? Well, he did. And a lot of people have left a lot of stuff behind them when they put the rock down, and they just then go into a time of prayer and they pray for each other, because tomorrow morning, back last Monday morning, we had people take them to the airport in Phoenix, and they flew home. Roger's got a song, and then we'll close our part of the service this evening.
In the brief time we're with you, we hope that we can communicate to you just how precious it is. We get to see close hand these miracles of healing and hope that the Lord does in the week-long retreats and counseling. It's just, wow. People who need to get the help from Jesus that they need, getting that help and getting back to ministry and marriage, wow. We're privileged. And we pray that you'll keep us in this ministry in prayer. This song is kind of paralleling the journey that Pastor Bill took from leaving his hopelessness behind and finding Jesus able to fill him with hope once again. The song's called Unbroken.
Until today, I believe without a doubt that I had gone down this road way too far to turn. Every lie that's been told could be untold. Every
what's been called the most dramatic air sea rescue in aviation history, anywhere, ever. So, two pilots, two passengers in one helicopter, one in the other, risked their lives for 25 minutes. They put the bellies of the helicopters into the swells of the ocean. And I have had rescue helicopter pilots that have heard me say that. One guy raised his hand and said, "You know that can't happen." I said, "I know." And we saw it with our own eyes. The only place to put us down was at the top of that island. So one, two, three, four, five, finally all seven of us got up there. And then they repositioned us in the helicopters and they flew us to Nome. Doctors and nurses started working on us. Back in the water, before we knew that anybody was coming for us, the youngest guy in our group, you know what a roadie is? The roadie's the guy that plugs in the sound system and stuff like that. 23-year-old Brian, before we knew if we were going to live or die, hollered Bible verses twice. He drifted so far from me, I have no idea where he was, but I could hear him. "God is our refuge and our strength, the very present help in trouble." A little while later, Brian hollered a verse that we all sang a few minutes ago. "This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." I remember thinking, that's the wrong verse. It's the rejoice and the be glad part that didn't seem to fit the occasion. You know what we can be glad about tonight? God's in the middle of every mess, every heartache, every disappointment, every pain, every hospital room, every nursing home. The Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego story about these guys in the fiery furnace. Who showed up in the furnace? The presence of God. The presence of God was felt in the Bering Sea. And if I could get some Lutherans here to talk, you've got stories of God's grace and God's mercy from your own life. We're not going to do that tonight, but I'd like to. Sometimes I think a congregation of people in the Lutheran church, they're sitting there with stories by the hundreds, and a lot of the stories have never been told. So I'm all for people giving, are you ready? Testimonies. Even in a Sunday morning worship service, one testimony every week or two or three would add a lot, I think, to a worship service. Just what my suggestion is, and then we leave town.
Yes.
Well, we're just really glad that because there was a rescue in the Bering Sea that defied all kinds of, I mean, we could not have survived what we survived. But because of that, some years later, there's another rescue story going on. And it's got to do with some people that are going to a retreat and dealing with burnout and stress and depression and conflicts and fragile marriages and things like that. I heard that the clients at our last retreat watched our video on Saturday night. And they kind of could come up for air on Saturday night. I guess they watched the whole the video that's out at the table. And in those times when I've been out at our retreat center and they've watched the video, I come in afterwards and say, "Has anybody got any questions?" There are a bunch of questions. And I look at some people and I say, "Isn't it good that God's a God of rescue?" And I'm preaching to the choir when I'm saying that because they're in the middle of it right at that moment. Let's just pray. Father, thank you that on the cross you rescued us, first and foremost. The greatest rescue of all time, when you paid for our sins. And then, Lord, throughout our lives, your hand of mercy is there. Your hand of rescue, your hand of grace, your hand of forgiveness. And we're sitting here tonight to say thank you for all of that. In Jesus' name. I thank you for letting us be part of your service this evening. And for those of you who are watching, if you want to make a gift to this ministry, you can go to our website, shepherdscanyonretreat.org, and hit that little button that says donate. Somebody did that today in Las Vegas, Nevada. I opened my cell phone, and here was a gift to the ministry of $35 from somebody whose name I didn't recognize from Las Vegas. And I typed a quick thank you for your gift back to that person. And in the offering this evening, the free will offering, the door offering, we would really appreciate your support of this ministry. This ministry is not supported by some, you know, deep pockets of some big foundation of any kind. It's supported by people like yourselves that support us in offerings and support us through the mail. And we are just so grateful. If you're writing a check, if you write it to Shepherd's Canyon Retreat, and you can take that envelope that you have in our handout, you can use it tonight, or you can put a stamp on it and mail it sometime. But we very much need people's support to just help us keep this ministry going. Thank you very, very much.
Let's stand for prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to have David Roger with us tonight and hear them share about the retreat center, but even more than that, your rescue. And that's really what you've done for each and every one of us. In one way or the other, you've rescued us. You've rescued us from sin, from death, from the power of the devil. You've given us life everlasting. And so in that rescue, we have opportunity to also reach out and help others to be rescued. Help us to know our Savior, Jesus, love him, believe in him, trust in him, and also invite others to know him as well. Lord, in your mercy. Father in heaven, we pray that you would be with all those who have physical needs. We pray especially for those in the hospital, Doug Beal, Dolores Dufek, and Linda Haig. We also pray for Barb Flagstad in hospice care and Kurt Meade preparing to have surgery tomorrow. We pray that you would be with those who are undergoing treatment. Wayne April, Linda Kennedy, Eleanor DeWinter, Sharon Eichmann, Ed Groh, Lori Harris, Sydney Heidke, Derek Kosmicki, Susan Kupski, Deanna Lang, Gail Maiden, Jennifer Nearing, Roger Nowak, Gene Palomino, Dave Tucker, Linda Whipperford, and myself. We also pray for those recovering. Klaus Becker, Bruce Burt, Karen Hansen, Jerry Herman, Bev Jablonski, Lynn Munster, Don Smith, and Shirley Strelo. In addition, we pray for those who have ongoing health problems, for Neil Anderson, Margie Berglund, Bill and Donna Branch, Laverne Burt, Luis Christopoulos, Ed Forrell, Wayne Grismel, Janet Grove, Orwell and Vi Howard, Ron Howard, Sue Kienitz, Ramona Kramer, Laura Lee, Susan Lotzow-Buss, Tom Mead, Michelle Nguyen, Marshall and Sheila Piotr, Mary Perlott, Janet Raddatz, Lowell Schrader, Phyllis Smeester, and Madonna Trotz. Grant healing, Lord, if it is your will. Grant them comfort and strength of body and perseverance and faith and trust for rescue from you, Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we pray for all those who are persecuted for their Christian faith, that they may stand firm no matter what threats they are facing, no matter where they're facing them, to remain true and faithful to you. We pray for those who are in the midst of natural disasters, recovering from hurricanes in the east and in the south, and wildfires in the west. All such things, Lord, we put these people in your hands. Provide for them, protect them, heal them, comfort them, Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would be with all those who are caregivers, who have loved ones who need regular, constant care, to grant them strength to be able to provide that care. We pray for families in crisis, especially during so many families are under attack. We ask that you would grant the healing that only you can give. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Father, we pray for all Christian ministries. We pray especially for Elliot and Serena Derrick's working with Lutheran Bible translators. We pray for our school ministries, at Trinity Lutheran School and NAW Lutheran High School, and all our sister congregations and their ministries here in Green Bay, throughout Wisconsin, and around the world. Fill us all with the joy of our salvation, giving praise to you for the gifts we have received from Christ and joyfully want to share with others. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for all those who serve in our armed forces, especially Christian Altergott, Paige Bogner, Tess and Sean LaRue, Roy McDonough, Garrett Moen, Maggie Knoll, Ron Pezzi, and Nathan Schrader. Help them, O Lord, to be faithful in the carrying out of their duties and courageous, and bring them home in peace again soon. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
And Father, we pray for our president, our governor, and all who are in positions of authority, both elected and appointed, especially during this election year. So many things are being spoken, some not very good. And we pray that you would bring to repentance those who have spoken ill or lies of others, and that you would bring the truth, that we might know that truth and use that truth to base our votes and guide our nation by those votes. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who out of love for his fallen creation humbled himself by taking on the form of a servant, becoming obedient unto death, even death upon a cross. Risen from the dead, he has freed us from eternal death and given us life everlasting. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And after the same manner also he took the cup. And after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
We'll come forward. You may be seated. Come forward for distribution. As we do that, we'll do the walking style communion that we have been doing. And so come to me, directly by the baptismal font, to receive the host. Go to whichever side you're sitting on to receive the cup, and then return back down to your seats by the side aisles and maintain social distance as you do so. And encourage you to sing along with Roger and Dave when they're leading songs during the distribution.
Just as I am with God.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Let's pause for a moment of silence.
Stop and take home some of those things if you possibly can.
If you know anybody up in Gleason, do you even know where Gleason is? No. Okay, I won't tell them that. They've done a bad PR job in Gleason for letting people in Green Bay know where they are. But anyway, I was going to say, or Wausau, Sunday morning at St. John's, or down in Marshfield, let people know. All of these churches are listed in our little schedule in the handout. We're just grateful to be here this evening, and so we're appreciative of your hospitality. We say thank you very, very much. Now, let's sing together. Come on, stand up.
Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me.
Are you sure about that?
Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Thank you very, very much for having us. God bless you.